There are a variety of stair types that may be used on a project. The geometry, layout, and finishes are based on the project needs and available space. This video is a part of a series of videos about the analysis and design of steel stairways. Please subscribe to not miss any of the future videos on this topic. Straight stairs are by far the most common type of stair. Although the term straight is self-explanatory, for purposes of classification, a straight stair is defined as one in which the stringers are straight members. The slope of straight stairs is typically less than 50 degrees. Straight stairs may be arranged in several different ways. Straight run consists of either a single flight extending between floors as shown, or a series of two or more flights in the same line with intermediate platforms between them. Parallel runs have successive flights which are parallel to each other and are separated by one or more intermediate platforms. Angled runs have successive flights placed at an angle to each other with an intermediate platform between each flight as shown. Stairs flights placed at an angle of 180 degrees are classified as parallel as shown in the previous example. Circular stairs are stairs that in plan view have an open circular form with a single center of curvature. They may or may not have intermediate platforms between floors. Curved stairs are stairs that in plan view have two or more centers of curvature, being oval, elliptical, or some other compound curved form. They also may or may not have one or more intermediate platforms between floors. In this type of stair, the treads are alternately mounted on the left and right side of a center stringer. Because of this tread construction and the use of handrails on each side, these stairs permit safe descent facing outward from the stair. The pitch angles used in these stairs typically are in the range of 50 to 70 degrees, will be much steeper than typical stairways used for means of egress. This type of stair is not acceptable as a path used for means of egress, except for certain special situations. If space permits, other stair types are typically preferred. Alternating tread stairs are more commonly used for maintenance access in areas not intended for access by the general public. In this type of stair, the treads are flat, and handrails are typically provided on both sides. Typically, same rules and slopes as alternating tread stairs apply. The class designation of a stairway is indicative of the type of construction, the quality of materials, details, and finish, and in most cases the relative cost. Stairs of all classes are built to meet the same standards of performance with respect to load carrying capacity and safety. As such, these class distinctions do not represent differences in functional value, but rather in character and appearance. Stairs of the industrial class are purely functional in character and consequently are generally the most economical. They are designed for either interior or exterior use in industrial buildings, such as factories and warehouses, or as fire escapes for emergency egress. This class does not include stairs that are integral parts of industrial equipment. This class of stairs serves chiefly functional purposes. Service stairs are usually located in enclosed stairwells and provide a secondary or emergency means of travel between floors. In multi-story buildings, they are commonly used as egress stairs. They may serve employees, tenants, or the public and are generally used where economy is a consideration. Stairs for this class are usually for public use and are of more attractive design than those of the service or industrial classes. They may be placed in an open location or may be located in closed stairwells in public, institutional, or commercial buildings. This classification applies to more elaborate and usually more expensive stairs, which are designed to be architectural features in a building. They may be wholly custom designed or may represent a combination of standard parts with specially designed elements such as stringers, guards, handrail, treads, or platforms. Usually, this class of stair has a comparatively low pitch with relatively low risers and correspondingly wider treads. Architectural metal stairs may be located either in the open or in enclosed stairwells in public, institutional, commercial, or monumental buildings. The following terms are going to be repeated throughout this video. This serves as a friendly reference in case some terms are unfamiliar or need a refresher. Dead loads include self-weight of the steel framing and connections, treads and risers, guards, handrail, and landings. Additional considerations include floor finishes, soffit covers, mechanical allowances, and architectural or aesthetic elements. In some cases, stair members may also support stud walls or partitions. An allowance of 5 to 10 pounds per square foot should also be considered when mechanical, electrical, plumbing, or fire protection components will be supported from the underside of the stair. The following table includes typical components that are additive to the stairway self-weight. IBC Chapter 16 and ASCE 7 Chapter 4 provide the typical live loads to be used and are summarized in this table. Both the concentrated loading and uniform loading should be checked. However, per IBC, these loads are not meant to be used together and the most severe loading should be used for design. It should be noted that factory, industrial, and storage occupancies in areas that are not accessible to the public and that serve an occupant load not greater than 50 are excluded from the uniform live load for guards. An additional consideration for live loads includes the possibility of unbalanced loading. Depending on the configuration of framing, certain unbalanced loading situations may produce more severe loading or deflections than a balanced condition. For exterior stairways, additional loadings should be considered, including wind loads, snow loads, rain loads, and ice loads. Depending on the size and layout of the stairway, environmental loads may control the design of individual elements. Wind loads should be based on the requirements of ASCE 7, Chapter 26. The minimum wind load to be used is 16 pounds per square foot. Snow loads should be based on the requirements of ASCE 7, Chapter 7. The minimum snow load to be used is 20 pounds per square foot. An exterior stairway that incorporates sloping landings and stair treads will likely not need additional review for rain loads. However, certain situations, including landings with longer spans where beam deflection may be larger than drainage slope, platforms incorporating drains, or where ice dams are possible, should be reviewed to determine if rain loads should be considered. In these cases, refer to ASCE 7, Chapter 8. Lattice structures, open catwalks, and platforms are all defined as ice-sensitive structures in ASCE 7, Chapter 10. Most stairways are not part of the seismic lateral force-resisting system, and determination of seismic forces can be determined from ASCE 7, Chapter 13, Seismic Design Requirements for Non-Structural Components. Egress stairways are required to function for life safety purposes after an earthquake and are therefore required to use the higher component importance factor IP of 1.5. The horizontal seismic design force FP is applied at the center of gravity of the component and must be applied independently in at least two orthogonal horizontal directions. Coefficients for architectural components for egress stairs are provided in this table. The following maximum limit and lower bounds apply to the equation of the horizontal seismic design force. Stairway systems and members should meet the minimum serviceability requirements given in the IBC deflection limits of this table. Additional requirements related to guards and handrails are provided in specification for permanent metal railing systems and rails for buildings in ASTM E985. These limits are provided in the lower table. The layout of stairways, guards, and handrails is presented here as a guide only. The actual requirements for stairways, guards, and handrails should be confirmed with the architect and local code officials. An overview of requirements for three types of stairways is presented in this table. The stairways included are a typical IBC egress stair, service, commercial, or architectural class. An IBC stair using minimum requirements and serving less than 50 occupants in industrial class, and an OSHA stair from an industrial class. These dimensions can be visualized as follows for an egress stairway based on IBC requirements. Treads and risers are responsible for carrying gravity loads between the stringers. There are several options for the construction of treads and risers, but the following are primarily used. Light gauge steel can easily be bent and shaped to the required geometry for treads and risers. It can be directly welded to the stringers or supported on carrier angles. Concrete fill can then be poured into the formed pan tread. For design, the concrete is treated as a filler, which increases the self-weight of the stair, but does not provide any additional strength. The tread and riser steel cross-section should then be treated like a beam and evaluated using AISC specifications, Chapter F, G, and H. We have discussed the design of beams for bending and shear in a previous video where we show the process in detail. Please click the link at the top or in the description below for this video. For walking surfaces, checkered or diamond plate is typically used because it has adequate strength and provides a surface with good traction. AISC Manual Table 3-18A and Table 3-18B list the maximum uniformly distributed service load for deflection-controlled applications and the maximum uniformly distributed load for flexural strength-controlled applications, respectively. For various thicknesses and spans for checkered plate based on ASTM A786. Table 3-18B presents the recommended maximum uniformly distributed load based on the stress limit of 24 KSI in LRFD. Table 3-18A presents the recommended maximum uniformly distributed service load based on a deflection limit of L over 100. Grading is typically preferred in wet environments, outdoor settings, industrial settings, and around equipment platforms. Grating allows small objects and liquids to pass through the flooring, so care should be used when grating will be above other occupied areas. Connections of grating to support framing include bolting, grating clips, or welding. Grating is typically purchased from a manufacturer, but designers should determine grating thickness, span direction, edge banding requirements, and other special features prior to ordering grating. Standard grating treads are made from 1.25-inch by 3/16-inch 19W4 serrated grating with bent checkered plate nosing. refer to the appropriate design standard or use information provided by the component supplier for non-steel options. This material can be precast concrete, glass, or wood. Designers should consider how non-steel options will interact with steel stair elements. For example, wood expansion or contraction when directly attached to a steel bar. Tolerances and applied forces from non-steel components should also be reviewed. Stringers are the members supporting treads and risers and span from floor level to floor level of the stair. Typically, the stringer will be on an incline but may also include horizontal runs. There are several different member types that can be used for stringers. Stringer support conditions and design assumptions will vary based on end conditions and the tread riser construction. The most commonly used stringer members are channels, plate, and rectangular hollow sections. In some cases, wide flange members and built-up shapes are used but are less common. The typical depth range for stringers is from 10 to 15 inches. A minimum of 10-inch depth is typically required to accommodate the layout of the treads and risers. Deeper stringers are typically used for longer spans to limit overall deflection. The following table lists some of the advantages and disadvantages of common stringer types. In the next video, we will discuss the different methods of analysis of stringers. We will also discuss the different design methodologies. Don't forget to like and subscribe and turn on the notification bell. Thank you for watching.